We are in Minsk during International Theater Festival named TIART 2017. And today we will have unique chance to talk with famous European theater director and composer Heiner Goebbels.
Я обожаю молнии, они все дремлющие, мгновенные, абсолютно достаточные. Необъятность за один миг. Все и быстро. Все это забвение, необходимое для того, чтобы пережить то, что уже было пережито тысячу раз, удивляет меня и вызывает скуку.
Mr. Goebbels, thank you very much that you agreed to say a few words to Fairlawn TV, public station in New Jersey. I know that you just came from airport directly to the first rehearsal.
I only slept 1 hour.
Wow!
Because I was in Venice.
Oh!
And then I had to make a stopover in Frankfurt and so on.
Oh, wow. It's a tough schedule, really tight one.
But I'm very happy. It's my first time to be in Belarus.
I see. I hope you will not be disappointed. Yeah.
The sun. Sun is shining.
Sun is coming.
Creating a wonderful shadow in your back.
Yeah. You are a director. You see everything. let me start from last year. Last year, you brought to New York your grandiose performance, Dimitry. Mm-hmm. It was shown in the Park Avenue Armory. I saw it.
I saw it.
It was big deal in New York. It was like really very impressive. And my first question would be like, did your expectation from this performance, like public reaction, critic reaction, are you satisfied with it? Do you have other plans for United States?
Indeed, I have. It was not my first time in the Armory. I did a piece in the Armory, I think in 2009, which is called Stift das Dinge, a piece without anybody, and just with five pianos and rain and fog and ice. And it was already very well received. And but I was in one point, I was skeptical about bringing the materie to the Armory, because it is quite, it's a wonderful music for me, it's a fantastic composer. And but these four movements, they are quite insisting. Can we just close the door?
All right.
In one point I was a little bit skeptical before, because these four movements of this fantastic music by Louis Andriessen, they are quite insisting, so they are not so entertaining, because they are insisting on one architecture in every movement, on a different architecture, on a different story, on a different approach, on a different style. And I thought maybe I was underestimating the American audience a bit, because I thought maybe this is too long, maybe it's not diverse enough, but I was completely overwhelmed by the reaction. It was fantastic. It was very very concentrated. We had also one show with 1,000 kids from the Bronx, which was as attentive and very well perceived, with a high concentration and with a good attitude towards something which you for sure haven't seen yet. Not only the fourth act with all the sheep, but also the other acts. They have quite a different way of minimalism when you compare it with American minimalist music, minimum music, then Louis Andriessen has a European way of reducing material in order to create a powerful strength. And no, I was very happy about the reception, about the visit, and the response was fantastic.
So do you have plans to come back?
I have new plans with the armory, probably, and not next year yet, but maybe in 19, we'll see, just discussing. I love this space, and I was used to work with big spaces when became artistic director of a German festival called Ruhr Triennale, and big industrial spaces. And so that's why I love the space, and I love to work with it in a way which really needs it, and not limiting the space, but rather opening the piece for the space, and have an encounter and a confrontation with the space itself, like in the material.
I see. And in one interview I read that you said that most of your theatrical performances you created in Switzerland, but you are a famous German director and composer. Does it mean that Switzerland found some ideal model for modern theater?
It's a bit more complicated because it is a structural question. It was one very specific theater in Switzerland which offered me already more than 15 years ago to create pieces in the way I needed. And this is a way which you don't find in Germany, because I need to work, I need to be free in the choose of my performance team. I need to be able to say, here I want to work only with pianos, or here only with sheep, and the next time only with one actor who doesn't live in Switzerland, but in Paris. So I need to be completely freed to create a new artwork. You have to be free, and to have not, you don't want to make compromises all the time. And the German theater system is super, it's very effective. We have 80 opera houses and 150 state theaters, but it is sort of a monoculture. So you have to have you have to work with the people of the ensemble. You have to work in a repertoire system, which means every night a different piece. So you cannot, the amount of preparation cannot be as sophisticated and as detailed as I needed, and that's why I really. Also now, I don't see in the moment a chance to work like this in Germany.
I see. Okay, so in this New York performance, Dimitry, one piece was dedicated to the lecture of Madame Curie to famous scientist, like beginning of 20th century. And now your new play, which you brought here also, it's Max Black and 62 Ways of
holding
the head with the
hand.
Yeah, it's also about scientists and scientists, and like you, as I see, you have like special interest in science. And another question: why did you choose this guy, Max Black, who was like born in Baku, like of Jewish descent, and immigrated to Great Britain and to USA? Changed the name from Chorny to Black.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he became kind of a British-American philosopher. Yeah. Why he is so interesting for you?
First of all, because of his name. He has a wonderful name. Yes. And I used his name as a title because I think it is an intriguing name. It's a longer story. We have some time yet? Yeah?
It's up to you.
Good.
It's just weird.
No, because it's not a completely new piece. I did this piece 20 years ago, in 98, nearly 20 years ago. And I did it for this little theater in Lausanne, Théâtre Bidi.
It's French theater?
It's French.
Oh, not German.
And I was looking for a theme, and I found in a book about logic, I found an article by Max Black, whose this article is called On Vagueness. On Vagueness. So, and he discusses the impossibility to be precise, for which is such a drag for any science, and which is actually the big advantage of an art piece, to be vague, not to be defined, not to be precise in its meaning, but to have an open imagination, and you can see a good painting, you can see it again and again, because you never know exactly what it means, and the same with a poem. So I was started to be interested in the relationship between art and science, and I found other philosophers who deal with the same question, and that one is Lichtenberg, a German scientist and from the 18th century, Paul Valéry from France, Wittgenstein from Austria, and they are all, and Max Black, and all four of them, they are scientists who don't work in a closed box. They were scientists who worked across the disciplines. They were talking about art, about language, about chemistry, about logic, about philosophy, all four of them. And the text you hear is a compilation of the four authors. And actually the smallest amount is from Max Black, but he had the best name. So that's why the piece is called Max Black. And to explain a little bit more, it is maybe something like a chain reaction, the piece, because what I was interested in was to find a balance between the different theater elements. Fire, I worked a lot with fire for this piece. Texts, of course, visuals, sounds and music, and the performer, and as a body. So theater, especially music theater, has so many different levels which you can perceive and which can reach you. And so this piece is a little bit like a chain reaction from one idea and a thought and a text to an action, to a fire experiment, to a sound which creates the soundtrack for the next scene. So it's always going through all possibilities which theater has. We performed this piece for 15 years with a French actor. And at one point we could not do it anymore. Also, the actor had other plans, and then I got this invitation from Moscow to do a piece, and I said, let's bring this Russian philosopher back to where he comes from, and with a fantastic Russian team and a fantastic Russian actor, we made a new version, of course, with new sounds and. But it's still the old piece, Max Black, which you will see here in Minsk.
Okay, so you came to Moscow to this Stanislavsky Electro Theater, mm-hmm. and you have possibility to choose any actor, and you choose Pantileev. And yes. In one interview, you said because he has special qualities.
Yeah.
Could you tell a little bit more? What special qualities you needed from?
He is impatient, mm-hmm. which is a very good driving force. Mm-hmm. He's super virtuose, very precise, and because it is a super complex piece, he has to communicate with the sound designer, has to communicate with the young composer who is recording all the sounds and send them back to the stage. Because this is the clue of this piece, is that all the sounds you hear are created by the actor in the way he is making experiments as a scientist. And then the sounds, they don't disappear, they come back and they choreograph his rhythm, the rhythm of his work. The sounds choreograph his next steps. So he had to accept the sound as a force, which, and also the objects with which he works. He has to accept the objects as a force which control him. They are on an eye level, the piano and him, or the fire and him. So he cannot control everything, because they have the chance for revenge. And Pantaleev, already in the very first tryouts, he was fantastic, very musical, which is important, because he's creating the rhythm which is basically the composition of the piece. It's created by the actor. So all these qualities made it very clear to me that I wanted to work with him, and it was right.
Okay, and maybe last question, which is very important for me. I will read the quote with reverse translation. It was printed in Russian. In Russian, and it says, "The task of the theater should not be reduced to telling stories." So I don't understand this idea of modern theater, that, like you mentioned, Stein, that you could do like play from everything. Mm-hmm. So do you think that playwriting has no sense today? People still try to use Shakespeare plays, Chekhov plays.
That's completely okay. That's completely okay. We should do that. These are great works. But we should develop the art form, like music has been developed away from Mozart and Bach and Beethoven, and visual arts have been developed. So why not theater too? And I think theater, I'm not against stories. Also, Max Black is full of stories, but not of one story. It's not one narration which you have to follow. It offers many different ways of reacting to it, and for the imagination of the audience. So somebody can see this piece and he doesn't listen to the text. He's only interested in the sounds. He keeps it like a landscape of sounds. Somebody is very much interested in the text and might not notice how powerful the light is in this piece. So there's different ways to see the piece. There's different stories possible. And what I'm mostly interested in is the enormous freedom which theater can have when it allows a very individual way to look at it.
Okay. I got your point.
Good.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Делайте более технически, ну, не играя карты. Because you're making a list.
То, что вы как бы делаете...
Я через сердце пропускаю, не надо этого делать, да?
Yes,
through my heart.
Yes.
I make it
through my heart. Skin your heart.
Абсолютная техника, холодный глаз, совершенно все.
Cold eye.
Okay.
Служит основой для стройной системы, не знает приблизительности и эфемерности, но при этом может воссоздать их с помощью своего искусства. С помощью... своего искусства. С помощью своего искусства. С помощью своего искусства. Про стул не говорят, ни сейчас он думает, ни сейчас он не думает, ни он никогда не думает. Не говорят этого про растения или про рыбу, разве что про собаку. Но вот про людей говорят, и то не про всех людей. Высказывание «стул не думает» несравнимо с высказыванием типа «стул не растет». Я понятия не имею, как бы это выглядело, если бы стул думал.
Мы сегодня продолжаем школу Тиарта, и сегодня, пожалуй, одно из самых ярких и важных событий – лекция Хайнера Гёббельса, композитора, режиссера, человека, который создает свой театр уже на протяжении многих лет. И мне очень приятно, что, во-первых, постановки этого режиссера мы можем увидеть в рамках Тиарта. Спасибо Анжелика Крашевская и Art Corporation, которые действительно привозят такие важные вещи из мира современного искусства и мира вообще в целом сюда, в Беларусь. А с другой стороны, мне крайне приятно, что Хайнер все-таки согласился прочитать нам лекцию.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here.
Я тоже очень рад быть здесь.
How long do you need to go from here to the theater?
А сколько нужно времени, чтобы отсюда добраться до театра?
40 минут? 40 минут? Нет.
Mit dem Auto, with car, by car, 20 minutes.
Yes, but not everybody has a car.
Да, но не у всех есть машина.
Okay, let's try. Again, thank you very much. I called this lecture Aesthetics of Absence.
Спасибо вам большое за еще раз спасибо вам большое. Я называю эту лекцию Эстетика отсутствия.
Because I think this is also what I tried to describe in a recent publication. I think this summarizes some very basic assumptions for my work.
Я называю ее эстетикой отсутствия, потому что я думаю, что она суммирует все мои исследования, все мои полученные знания, моих работ.
And I love to be in this space. I love industrial spaces.
Я очень люблю быть в таких местах. Я очень люблю индустриальные места.
And a number of productions which I will show you have been created or performed or both in industrial spaces.
И некоторые из пьес были поставлены и сделаны в таких индустриальных местах.
For a very good reason, I think. For a very good reason.
И это было очень замечательно, это было очень хорошо.
Because I think that somehow you can't fake anything in an industrial space. The reality of the space asks you also to reflect your ideas about theater.
Я думаю, что в индустриальных местах, в таких помещениях нельзя ничего придумать, нельзя ничего выдумать, потому что реальность индустриальных мест, она заставляет вас задумываться, задавать себе вопросы, рефлексировать.
Those spaces are not generous, they don't forgive you.
И это такие места, они не щедрые, они вас не прощают.
And especially they don't forgive you if you pretend to do something.
И особенно они не прощают, когда делаешь вид, что что-то делаешь.
When you, as a performer, as a theater maker, when you do as if.
Если человек как актер или как режиссер делает как будто.
And this is maybe a general critique which I have to theater. It's a critique of representation. It's a critique of doing as if.
Да, и это главный вопрос, который я критикую в театре, это делать что-то как будто.
So I very much believe in an art form, or in theater as an art form, which is a reality by itself.
И я верю в театр как форму искусства, которая создает свою реальность.
I believe in theater as not in theater as a reality by itself, and I don't believe in theater which pretends to make statements on reality.
И я не верю в театр, который делает вид, что он создает реальность.
And this is what happens very often in theatrical, conventional theatrical productions, especially in political conventional theater productions.
Но это часто происходит в театральном, ну, в театральном мире, особенно в тех моментах, которые имеют политическую окраску.
That directors want make statements on reality, and by this they underestimate the experience and also the cleverness of an audience.
Когда режиссеры хотят что-то сказать о реальности, хотят выразить реальность, вот, и они создают свою собственную, которая не соответствует.
And it's actually this is true nearly for everything which you use in theater.
И это правда, и это соответствует, ну, относится практически каждому моменту в театре.
It was, for example, Heiner Müller, the East German playwright, Heiner Müller, with whom I worked a lot. He once said.
Есть немецкий писатель, его зовут Хайнер Мюллер, с которым я работал, и он однажды сказал.
He once said, the texts should not be reduced in order to make statements on reality. The texts should be on theater should be used as a reality by itself.
Text should be used or reduced.
Should be not be reduced.
Тексты нельзя сокращать, уменьшать для того, чтобы что-то сказать о реальности. Они должны создавать реальность.
And when we go through some examples of my work.
Если мы посмотрим на некоторые примеры моей работы.
I will try to explain and insist on the explanation of what I mean with reality by itself.
Я буду показывать и настаивать на том, что я имею в виду под реальностью как таковой.
And to start with the idea of aesthetics of absence, I could just show you a video.
И чтобы начать говорить об эстетике отсутствия, я хотел бы показать вам видео.
It's actually not a video by my own work.
Это не видео моей собственной работы.
But it's a video of a work which I produced.
Но это видео работы, которую я режиссировал.
Which I produced when I was artistic director of festival in Germany.
Когда я работал директором фестиваля в Германии.
It's a festival. It's called Ruhr. Triennale, and this is dedicated especially to industrial spaces.
Этот фестиваль называется Рур Триеннале, и он специально, этот фестиваль специализируется на индустриальных местах.
And I try to find artists who accept a space as a partner, as a strong partner, and not only as a decor for something.
Я пытался найти актеров, которые понимали бы пространство как партнера, как сильного партнера, а не как часть декора.
And so I invited Romeo Castellucci, an Italian artist.
И поэтому я пригласил, wie heißt er?
Romeo Castellucci.
Romeo Castellucci.
And he produced several pieces for my festival.
И он сделал несколько пьес для моего фестиваля.
And one of the production was called Sacre de Printemps, The Rite of Spring by Igor Stravinsky.
И одно из произведений называли, wie heißt das nochmal?
The Rite of Spring.
Право, Священная весна Стравинского.
Okay. So what Romeo did was that he constructed machines who could send out the dust of bones.
The dust?
Dust of bones.
Машины, которые смогли распылять пыль от костей.
It's actually the dust of 70 cattle, 70 cows.
И это были кости 70 коров.
And he choreographed the dust of bones in the rhythm of the music of Stravinsky.
И он настроил вот выпадение пыли под музыку Стравинского.
Because he said that this whole idea of sacrifice as a dance is already a misunderstanding.
И что вот эта вся идея жертвенности как танец, она очень непонятная.
It's not, sacrifice is not something which can be danced by 20 girls, ballerinas.